Hello, technologists, wherever you are. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 172, USRP and RFNoC update, all from the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference last September in Austin, Texas. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. So let's see, USRP and RFNoC. A lot of initials there. Tell you what, Matt Ettus, N2MJI, founder of Ettus Research, is going to be doing the presentation. And Matt, maybe you can give us a kind of a concise idea of what it is you're going to be talking about in this presentation. Let's start with USRP, the Universal Software Radio Peripheral. What is that?
Really, you should think of this like a software-defined cell phone without the touchscreen.
Okay, that helps, I guess. How about RFNoC, RF, radio frequency, network on a chip? Tell me about that.
RFNoC allows you to drag and drop components in the FPGA and draw arrows between them.
Also very helpful. Right, Bear? Well, USRP has been around for a while, but Matt's got some new products in that line. RFNoC is completely new, and I'm pretty sure you're interested in hearing about all of it. So we'll get to all of that right after we thank the people who put up the cash that paid for me to haul my equipment all the way out to Austin, Texas, and record everything and then haul it back here and get everything online. They are our Kickstarter backers, of course. It begins with the 108 hams who contributed between 10 and 150 bucks as individuals. And by the way, they're the ones who were promised that 30-day window of exclusivity to watch the programs before anyone else, and they are the ones who said, we don't need it, get them out there as soon as possible. So instead of watching this in December, you get to see it here in November. Now, the lesson is that they don't need gimmicks to support TAPR and Ham Radio Now. Unfortunately, sales and marketing departments are kind of addicted to gimmicks, and many customers are too, so I can't promise that we won't try it again next year if we can think of a good one, but maybe not. Maybe we'll skip the gimmicks. Well, next, I want to thank the $500 corporate underwriters. I'll put that in little air quotes. For that kind of money, they get to have me say a few nice things about them. Or in the case of the first one, they can speak for themselves because they do it so well.
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, September 7th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 650.
This is No Agenda.
Adam Curry is KF5SLN. John C. Dvorak is KJ6LNG. But this is not another one of those ham radio podcasts. Weren't you listening just now, all that media assassination stuff? Twice a week, on Sunday and Thursday, Adam and John take on the media, politicians, entertainers, anybody who's not being as real as they probably ought to be. And Adam likes me, so I guess I'm safe, and, you know, that's something. You can listen live or by Memorex on their website, noagendashow.com. There goes the bear. Or on most podcast apps. We're also brought to you by TAPR. TAPR sponsors the DCC, of course. And if you're interested in anything digital in amateur radio, hardware, software, data, voice, television, you'll be at home at TAPR. Matt Ettus, the guy who's going to do this talk, says that he was inspired to start doing what he does by attending the DCC. So that's cool. If you are getting a lot out of the DCC videos and you're not already a TAPR member, please consider joining. Stop by their website. It is tapr.org and check them out. And we're brought to you by several hams who encourage you to look into this group, hackersforcharity.org. Now, you guys know that the word hackers really means people who love to dig into their computers and software and make them do cool things. Maybe a little unorthodox, but not necessarily evil. Hackers for Charity was founded by Johnny Long. You might have heard of him. He figured out that he and you could use your hacking skills to help out people around the world who really need you but can't begin to afford you. They're headquartered in Uganda, and you can actually go there if you want. But they got plenty of things for you to do from the comfort and convenience of your own computer desk. Maybe you'll start with just buying a t-shirt or donating some old gear. So check them out at hackersforcharity.org, and remember that Hackers for Charity did not put up the money for this announcement. It was put up by some fellow hams who just believe in that cause. We are brought to you by the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force at aretf.org. Now, I'm able to see this website, and you're able to watch this video because there are standards. Yeah, this isn't news, especially for this audience. Also not news is that in amateur radio, standards can be a little bit harder to come by. So Brian, K7UDR, and Kenny, KU7M, launched ARETF, patterned after the IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force. And a guiding principle is that you can't tell people, especially hams, what to do. You have to form a consensus, and then maybe most people will adopt a standard formed from that general agreement. They're just getting started, so if you think they're onto something and maybe you'd like to help or just keep an eye on what they're up to, check out the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force at aretf.org. And we're brought to you by an enthusiastic supporter of Ham Radio Now and Tapper, who still wishes to remain anonymous. Still anonymous. I know who he is. I'm not telling. You can't make me. This ham, though, is a regular attendee of the DCC for over 30 years. He's very enthusiastic about what the DCC and Ham Radio Now are able to do together. And finally, if you're watching these DCC programs and you didn't get in on the Kickstarter that we ran to pay for it, you still want to help, you can. Stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. You'll find our mascot, Arvin the Piggy Bank. He's sitting back there on the shelf. Here's what he looks like online. You'll find him, click on him, and he will take you to our contribution page where you can use PayPal or a credit card. And my thanks to everyone who has contributed to Ham Radio Now and the Kickstarter. And now it looks like Steve Bible is gearing up for Matt's talk down there in Austin.
Gary, you ready?
I am, Steve. Take it away.
Let me get around over here. Then I'd like to introduce Matt Ettus and to MJI. It's great to have Matt again. And he's speaking about USRP update and the RFNoC. All right, RFNoC system for system simplifying DSP design on FPGAs. Take it away, Matt.
Okay, I've got probably more than I can fit in the 45 minutes, so I'm gonna go through things relatively quickly, but feel free to interrupt me if I'm glossing over something quickly. Just a quick history. So 12 years ago this month at the DCC, I put up this slide. This was my idea for what later became the USRP, and I said, somebody please make this. Nobody did, so I made it, and that became the USRP 1. And 10 years ago this month, I quit my regular job and started Ettus Research to commercialize and sell these devices. So it's 10 years today, and actually 17 years, or not 10 years today, but 10 years this month, and SDR was actually a concept that I first heard about at a DCC in 1997 when Dwayne Hendricks gave a talk about it, and I knew it was something important and interesting at the time, and it has certainly it's consumed the last 14 years of my life. So I'm glad to be back at DCC. I guess I missed a couple years, but yeah, it's great to be back here. Who here is familiar with USRPs and our products? Okay, not everybody, but a lot of people. So the USRPs are software-defined radios, and actually, well, here's the block diagram that still applies to this day, although it's not necessarily USB, but you have an application on one side that uses GNU radio in most cases, a computer, and then an interface to a board that then has analog components and then transverters to get you to RF frequency bands of interest. So that's the basic concept that USRPs have had for the whole 12 years of their existence. This is our most common device. It was a view inside the box of the USRP N series, the N200 series. So it's the basic concept is you have an Ethernet connection to a host computer where you do most of the interesting processing, and then you have this box that connects by Ethernet. It has an FPGA and then an RF board and some A to Ds and D to As. And this one in particular allows you to deal with signals in general up to 25 megahertz wide. So pretty wide for most ham applications. It has decent sized FPGAs and high speed A to Ds and D to As. You can expand it to do MIMO applications, so multiple antenna systems like 802.11n, that kind of style of communications. So this has been very popular for a number of years. I guess since 2010 or so, we've been selling these, and that's the bulk of what our users use. But I'm going to tell you about a couple of new developments in a moment. But so the motherboard takes. The motherboard is the analog baseband to digital interface, and then we have these RF daughter boards that give you access to different frequency bands. So the three most common are the WBX, which gives you all the way from 6 meters through 2.2 gigahertz, so there's a whole lot of ham bands in there. There's the SBX, which has a somewhat higher range, and then the CBX, which covers some of the lower microwave bands. But coming soon, like end of this year, we'll have one board that just does 10 meg to 6 gig, all in one, so you no longer have to switch out boards. And it'll give you 40 megahertz of bandwidth on those N200s that I just showed you, and 160 megahertz of bandwidth, instantaneous bandwidth, on our X300 product family, which is a higher-end device that I'll show you in a moment. But probably the device that's most interesting to amateur radio people is this. It's called the B200 or the B210. The difference is that the B210 has the MIMO, two antennas, whereas the B200 just has one antenna. So that's a B210 being passed around. The B200 would have a few less components on the same board. So this is an all-in-one device. It really covers 50 meg to 6 gig. It's officially 70 meg, but goes to 50 meg to 6 gig. 2x2 MIMO on the B210, has a good-sized FPGA on there, and it has a USB 3 interface, and it's bus-powered, so you don't even need a separate power supply. You could just plug over a USB cable, and it runs off of that. It gives you up to 56 megahertz of instantaneous RF bandwidth. You can do full duplex. You can do GSM base stations on this. You can do LTE base stations with it. You can even do MIMO, 2x2 MIMO LTE base stations with this, with free software, actually. So we're really excited about this. It's been out for about a year now, and the B200 costs $675. So it's definitely within a ham budget. It's not soft rock price, but I think it's a really compelling solution for amateur radio. So this is a picture of it, and it's being passed around, so you'll see it a little closer. But over here you have the USB 3 interface, and it'll work with USB 2, but of course reduced bandwidth. These are 10 megahertz and PPS reference inputs. This is a GPS input. There's an optional module that goes on there to do GPS disciplining of the oscillator to get very accurate frequency. GPS interface chip, FPGA. And then this is an RFIC that basically has the entire 2x2 MIMO transmit and receive front end all in one chip. And then there's some ancillary components, and then you have your 2x2 MIMO connections on there. And so the B200 would just have two of those SMAs on the far end. So that's the B200. Has anybody here used a B200 in any form? Okay, great. I'll have it over in the demo room later if you want to see it. I was just using one actually with this GNU radio Flowgraph. I got a new house, and it has automatic garage door openers, but none of the clickers. Didn't come with it. It was an estate sale, so we weren't able to ask the previous owner for them. So I just made this Flowgraph in GNU radio basically do amplitude modulation. So this is the USRP in the flow graph. So signal comes in and the USRP transmits it. We set the frequency. That's the sample rate. We set the frequency here. It's a little off screen right now. This is basically AM modulation. This is an interpolator because it's such a low data rate for these garage door clickers that I wanted to use a sample rate that's 1,000 times higher. So we interpolate by a factor of 1,000 there. And then this is the vector source, and I just wrote a little short Python program to try all the codes. And so I set it off, and it tries one a second, so I can tell which one actually made the door open up, and it made the doors open up. And so then I could go buy a new control and set the dip switches. Now, I do have, these are the sort of the older garage door openers without the rolling codes. Those would be a little harder to work with. But this is a sort of a 90s era garage door opener. So this was fun. It took me, you know, an hour or so to get this going on a Saturday afternoon. But it shows you sort of the power of GNU Radio and what you can do, you know, really quickly, you know, with, you know, with low-cost hardware. So, oops. So anyway, so that's the B200. Next, I'm going to talk about what we're calling our third generation of products. So our first generation was the USRP 1. It had a USB 2 interface, and it's really got samples in and out of the computer, but there wasn't a lot more complexity beyond that. The second generation was the USRP 2s, the N200s, the B200 that you see there. And the idea with one of the big advancements there was that you had precise timing control. And this allowed you to do things like TDMA protocols. And so you could transmit at a very specific time. You could set frequencies at specific times. So you could much more easily do things like frequency hopping or TDMA or time slotted protocols like GSM and things like that. And so now our third generation, what we're really concentrating on there is first very wide bandwidth, very wide MIMO, and taking advantage of the very large FPGA sizes that are available today. So all of these devices are 56 to 160 megahertz in RF bandwidth, and we'll, you know, even be going past that in the future. Massive MIMO scalability. We actually have some some systems being employed with 100 plus antennas. And this is actually a really active area of research in wireless communications. And I'd love to talk about it more. It's sort of beyond the scope of this. But having many, many antennas opens up a lot of possibilities in terms of getting a lot more through the same bandwidth with more reliability. So the three families, the B200 is sort of a 2.5 generation device, but the other two third generation devices are the high capacity X300 that I'm going to show, and it's you know, sort of out of a ham price range. It's really more of a professional level device, but also the E300, which is our embedded handheld device. But both of these have this really big FPGA on there, and FPGA programming has been difficult. And not an efficient process. And so we came up with this RF network on chip architecture, or RFNoC, really aimed at making the FPGA a lot easier to program and allowing us to take advantage of the capabilities that these FPGAs provide. So the latter part of the talk, I'll get into RFNoC and how that works. So the X300 gives you 160 megahertz of RF bandwidth on each antenna, and it does 2x2 MIMO. So that would be, you know, and it does full transmit and receive full duplex. So you can have two antennas transmitting 160 megahertz each and two antennas receiving 160 megahertz each. So you could call that a grand total of 640 megahertz of useful RF bandwidth. 200 megasample per second A to Ds at very high precision, 800 megasample DACs. You can use 1 gigabit Ethernet. You can use 10 gigabit Ethernet. You can use CPRI, which is popular in the cell phone base station world. And you can also use PCI Express. So you have a lot of choices how to interface to your computer. None are as convenient as plugging in with USB, but unfortunately, USB really doesn't offer the reliability or the bandwidth that these other interfaces do. It has a very big Kintec 7 FPGA, a lot of onboard DRAM for scratch space and storing large amounts of samples. You can lock it to GPS. And it uses our standard RF daughter board, so the WBX, SBX, CBX, and coming UBX that I talked about earlier. So if you put two UBXs on this, you would get 10 megahertz to 6 gig coverage with 160 megahertz each in a 2x2 MIMO system. So the X300, you know, you can stream incredible amounts of bandwidth over 10 gigabit Ethernet. At very low latency, and that should allow you to do things like 802.11ac in your host computer. 802.11 in particular has a very tight turnaround time, and so latency is quite key to that. It'll work with LabVIEW FPGA, which is a different software package that's made by our parent company, which allows you to do graphical programming of a lot of things, control systems, wireless comms, and that sort of stuff. And it's auxiliary I.O. for controlling external amps, and it's rack mountable. Did somebody have a question?
When you say low latency, you mean between the moment I tell it to transmit and the signal goes up?
Yeah, so the way I define latency there, the actual is if I'm receiving a signal over the air and something happens on that signal, how long does it take for that signal to come into the computer and me to react to it and then transmit something in response? So if something comes into the antenna, I can get a response to it out 10 microseconds later. That's a round-trip latency.
So round-trip latency, so 10 microseconds between I hear the tone and I send the command to launch the missiles.
Exactly.
Thank you.
We haven't been used to launch missiles, to my knowledge, but we have been used in some really interesting rocketry applications where latency was also a key.
And it sounds like you're the company behind pervasive surveillance.
We are not. There are many, many companies behind pervasive surveillance, unfortunately. And I look at what we make as a hammer, and you can hammer nails with it or you can hammer heads with it. And unfortunately, all of these things, more and more heads are getting hammered with them, unfortunately. We do get a lot of people who call up and say their neighbor is spying on their cell phones with these things and they're very upset with us. And I assure them it's probably not the case and they should seek help. But I also, some people's cell phones are being spied on with these, unfortunately. But that's the nature of modern technology. So this is a picture of the device. I don't have one here, but it's sort of pizza box shaped. It's half a rack unit in width and a full rack unit high. So this is the front and the back panel. So on the front panel, you can see we have the two-way MIMO antennas connections. We have our GPIO connection and a JTAG port. For anybody who's ever used a Xilinx FPGA, you know how useful ChipScope is. You no longer need that red box or black box from Xilinx with a USB connection and a little ribbon cable. We have built that functionality into the device. You just connect to a USB cable and it uses all the standard Xilinx tools for ChipScope, for all the other JTAG stuff. So you can configure the device over JTAG. It also has internal flash, and you can configure over Ethernet or PCI Express. But it's nice to have the front panel JTAG. You don't even have to open it. You can do ChipScope, which comes in handy when you're developing on FPGAs. On the back, we have power, our dual 10 gig or 1 gig ports, which can use optical or copper, frequency and time reference in or out, frequency and time reference in, GPS in, and that's PCI Express over cable. So it doesn't sit in your computer if you use PCI Express. You use a separate card that goes in the computer and then a cable to the box. And this is the inside. So we've got under this heatsink is the DRAM and a very big FPGA. This is the 10 gig Ethernet. This is mostly power supply on the sides here. And then we have our two daughter board connectors here, and then our clocking circuitry is in the middle. So that's X300. Any questions about that guy?
How much?
Well, those are sort
of,
okay. Those are in the 4,000 and up range. It's really intended as a research device and a professional radio device. But the nice thing is that you've got the $675 radio on one side, all the way up through this with you can use the same software across them. And so, for example, that LTE stack I talked about, it works on every single one of these devices, and the people writing it only had access to one of the three. And it just ran with all three out of the box because our driver system abstracts away the hardware complexities and gives you a nice clean interface that has the handles and the knobs that you would like for a software radio, and it gets the complexity of the actual chips involved out of the way. So that's the X300. The next device in this third generation is the E300. So E is embedded, so this is based around the Xilinx Zinc chip, and so that is if you're not familiar, it's a dual-core ARM Cortex A9, so it's roughly a cell phone class processor, a smartphone class processor, with a large programmable logic area. So it's an FPGA plus an ARM in one package, and it has a gig of DRAM. And so we run Linux on that processor, along with GNU Radio and all the standard tools. And you know, it also, because it's just straight up Linux, you can do things like, you know, you can run Firefox and check your email on it, all that stuff as well, not just SDR. You could do your compilation on the device, or you can cross-compile from a host computer. It has the same integrated RF as the B200, so it does the 50 meg to 6 gig, 2x2 MIMO, lots of bandwidth. This one also contains analog filter banks to attenuate strong out-of-band signals. And so it has a gig Ethernet and a USB connection, but these aren't really for transferring samples like we would with our other devices to a host, because this device contains the host. You can think of this as having the computer plus the radio in one box. The Ethernet is really for networking of the device at a higher level, not just sending raw samples, although you could do that. And the USB is for attaching any sort of peripheral that you might attach to a regular computer with USB. It has GPS synchronization, stereo audio in and out for push-to-talk applications, and 10-axis IMU, so accelerometers, gyros, magnetometers, altimeter. So really, you should think of this like a software-defined cell phone without the touchscreen. It is roughly cell phone-sized. We took my old cell phone and measured it and used that as our size goal. So it's about 60 millimeters by 120. It is thicker than a cell phone. It's about an inch thick. But it is otherwise cell phone size. It's battery powered, full Linux distribution, and you know, a lot of choices of software. So, oh, that's not scaled properly. so let's get the proper picture here. So this is the actual picture when scaled somewhat properly of the device. That's a pencil there for comparison in size. And this is actually orderable now. It's not on our webpage yet. And we will start shipping them before the end of the month. We're going to have the formal announcement at GNU Radio Conference, which is in 2 weeks in Washington, D.C. And actually, I would have invited you all to come, but it's actually sold out at this point. But we are going to have over 150 people at the GNU Radio Conference this year, which we're very proud of. This is our fourth annual conference. And it's always a lot of fun and very exciting. And if anybody is in the DC area and can't manage to get tickets, we'll still have some social events in the evening. So send me an email if you want to get together with everybody and discuss SDR over beer.
How much is this one?
This one is, there's a lot of configurations. The basic configuration is 2,500. But we will have, as time goes on, we'll have stripped down versions that, for example, don't have MIMO, take away a little bit of the RAM to get the price even lower. But this has, this, you know, is essentially the computer and the radio in one. This is the back panel of the device. I guess it's arbitrary what you call back, but the ports are, we've got power, which also charges the battery, so it runs on 5 to 17 volts, actually. Gigabit Ethernet. The shipping one, this is an older picture, has two USB ports. So it's if you have a Wi-Fi dongle, a flash drive, or a 3G modem that you want to use for backhaul, you can plug it in. Any USB device that works with Linux will work on here. So you have monitor, keyboard, mouse as well, you can plug them in on USB. This is the USB console, so it's like a USB serial port for debug purposes. And then that's the board itself. Actually, we don't have a good picture of the front, but you can see here, the front has the 2x2 MIMO antenna connections. Below it, there's another connection for GPS and a connection for a synchronization signal, which can be 10 megahertz or PPS or something like that. It also has the power switch and a little slot for the micro SD card. The whole operating system is stored on the micro SD card, and so you can, you know, click it and take it out and replace it if you like. So we think there's a lot of really cool uses for this. It's going to be in one of the early ones is going to be up in a balloon, an amateur radio balloon, small portable spectrum monitoring, small UAVs, wireless sensor nodes, that sort of thing, handheld communicators. And again, we're really excited about this, and we're sure that there's going to be all sorts of interesting applications that we haven't even thought of yet. We're hoping to shrink it down a lot and get one into a satellite, but that's a little ways off. So any questions about any of those? Okay. So we come to RFNoC. Now we have all these devices with now these really, really massive FPGAs. So this is just a generational, explanation of what kind of FPGA space we have. And the actual numbers aren't really that important. The important thing is when you look at our Gen 3 devices, you have massive amounts of logic, memory, very high bandwidths and data rates, and particularly a lot of free space in the FPGA when the basic image is loaded. So what do we do to take advantage of this extra space? And in particular, the way I like to put it is that our FPGA capability is scaled with Moore's law, but our budgets, our time, and our resources, our number of grad students who are working for us, all has not scaled with Moore's law. And so in order to take advantage of all of this, you have to become more efficient. You have to find a better, higher level way of programming rather than using what is equivalently assembly language that is typically used in FPGAs. And at the same time, you have people who really know algorithms and communication systems. They don't want to become experts in FPGA design and networking and Verilog and all this low-level stuff in order to produce their systems. And we have very poor reusability. Reusability of code has for the most part been solved in computers, right? You have shared libraries, you have APIs and different systems to allow an algorithm to be written once and lots of different people to use it. But that's been an utter failure in the FPGA and ASIC worlds. And every time you want a FIR filter, everybody writes their own fresh new FIR filter to have the specific interfaces that you want. And so it results in very, very low productivity. And changing an FPGA, it takes seconds to load a new configuration, but it might take hours to compile a new configuration and months to develop it. So how do we fix that? And so that's really what we are tackling with RFNoC. And so now if we can fix that, I think this gives us a lot of new freedom. We can start to treat FPGAs like something other than a rewritable ASIC. We can start to treat them as flexible computation engines and when I say rewritable ASIC, an ASIC has this, it's like a 2-year cycle and then and it's this very long time cycle between idea and working system. And we're trying to shrink that. And FPGAs should be able to do that, but the tools have prevented us from really solving that problem. And so I look at two axes in this problem. There's how do I express my algorithms efficiently? And then how do I tie together algorithms into larger systems? And expressing the algorithms, we are not tackling with RFNoC. There's a lot of different ways that people are attacking that problem. Some of them are successful in ways and some not. What we're really looking at is how do we take those algorithms, once you've expressed them in this higher level system other than Verilog, how do I tie them together and make a real system out of it and in a flexible way? And that's really what we're tackling with RFNoC. And so we have considered and valued code reuse and composability of blocks, which are core principles of software but haven't been of hardware. And we're trying to apply those principles to hardware. So this is goal. I showed you GNU Radio Companion before, and what we want to accomplish is you to be able to do a GNU Radio Companion-like thing where you drag and drop some blocks and draw some arrows between them and have a working flow graph. That's the vision. We want that in hardware. So this is a software thing right now, but you know that this will work in some sense because these ports are the same color, so you know they're floating point numbers, streams. So I can just connect these arrows and it'll function. It may not do something logically intelligent, but at least it will connect properly. And that's what we're bringing to RFNoC. So RFNoC allows you to do this, drag and drop components in the FPGA and draw arrows between them. And actually at a higher level, it even adds something else which you don't get in a GNU Radio straight up, which is the arrows are dynamic. They're not even fixed at runtime. They can change throughout the operation. And so that's what RFNoC really brings. So just to give an example of why this is so important, this is a diagram of what goes on inside a USRP N200, so one of our second generation devices. And the detail isn't really important, but let's say you have a signal comes in on the daughter board, it's sampled by the A to D, and it goes through our fixed function DSP. It goes through a digital down converter, a decimator, and then it goes into the host. Now let's say you've got extra FPGA space, you want to put an FFT in there. So okay, so you put the FFT right here. But what happens, sometimes you want to bypass it, so you have to draw a bypass path around it. And sometimes you want the FFT over here, or sometimes you want an FIR filter. And you can put all those things in and have little muxes and switches to go around them, but the complexity quickly explodes, and it's just completely non-scalable. And so it becomes very efficient. So how are we solving that? This is the diagram of what goes on inside an X300 or an E300 device. So we have four major components. We have our radios, which is really the logic that controls the hardware part of the radio. So this would then connect to A to Ds and D to As out here. So this is logic that controls the hardware. We have computation engines, which are where we put our interesting algorithms. We have our interfaces to the outside world, and then we have a router, which is really a crossbar switch, which allows data to go between all of these devices. And it's a packet-switched router, not a circuit-switched router, meaning you can dynamically decide where packets go and where data flows, how data flows between these blocks. And that's critical because now you can have an FPGA image that might have 10 different computation engines, and any algorithm might use some subset of them. But they're all there, and they're ready, almost like separate functional units that are just available for you when you need them, and they don't get in the way when you don't. So so the principles of the RFNoC system have a very simple API around your blocks, and that's critical. Because, again, in FPGA design, APIs have not been a key part of it. So every one of these blocks has the exact same interface, and every one of them can be pulled out and replaced with a different one. And so that means everybody can write their stuff separately and know that they'll work together. And that gives you a lot of flexibility, a lot of scalability that you don't get in your normal processes. I'm not going to go over some of the details like the ACSI FIFOs and stuff, but all the communication is packet-oriented. So we have samples coming into the radio at A to D converter rates and going out at D to A converter rates, and that's synchronous, and it's sample-oriented. But the radio block, the orange block on the right side there, takes those and packetizes them and timestamps them and then sends it as a packet through the network. And what that means is that everything in the network can operate asynchronously. And if you care about the time, you go by the timestamps on the packets rather than when you're getting the data. And that's critical because now everything can operate in its own clock domain. It makes it easier to meet timing. The packets can even be operated on a separate device. You can scale these networks across many FPGAs. So you can now have a many FPGA computational system very easily and transparently to the design that you're making. So the principles are all these packets is only one form of packet. There's all one protocol, one form of packet. And those packets contain samples, symbols, other packets. They can contain control. They can contain flow control. Everything is all in one packet format. So everything can route this format, and everything understands it. And so it makes it very easy to interface devices without having to talk to the guy who wrote the other piece. And any point, any block in this system can talk to any other block. And so this allows you to have systems without a host computer or a system with many host computers. And it's really a distributed system of asynchronous nodes. And this allows you to scale much better than having one single point of control. And so I talked about the radio blocks as the first of the four types. The radio blocks contain everything that has to happen in the actual sample clock domain. So these are the only things that know the real true wall clock time. And they do all precise timekeeping and sequencing. They control the hardware. Incoming samples that are synchronous, they put in a packet and send it into the asynchronous network. And on reverse, they receive packets from the network, convert it into synchronous samples, and send it out to the DAC at the right time. Everything else, all the interesting DSP beyond the decimation, you put elsewhere in the network in a computation engine. And so it can be on a different device, it can be across the network, and it can be choosable at runtime or even dynamically during operation. So then we have computation engines, which are really, they're really the reason why we're here. The computation engines are, the whole point of the system is you can add these and create arbitrary processes in the device. And so some of them are obvious, right? FFTs, FIRs, modulation, demodulation make total sense for a computation engine. But there's also some that you might not think of in when we call it a computation engine. Things like control. So you could have a frequency hopping state machine. Because the interfaces all carry control packets as well as data packets, these blocks can do control operations. So they could cause that you can write a block to do AGC, and it doesn't have to interfere with your signal path. Everything can just, the signal can go around it, and it can handle the gain. You can have a block to just do frequency hopping, and it doesn't need to deal with samples. It just deals with the frequency hopping. You can do protocols and upper layer stacks and things like that. Your computation engine doesn't have to be hard-coded logic. It can be a CPU. It could be a microblaze compiled into the FPGA. It could be a memory buffer. It could be a core i7 on a separate machine as long as it obeys the same protocol. It doesn't even have to be in the FPGA. It could be a GPU. Anything that can obey the RFNoC protocol can be across many interfaces on a completely asynchronous other kind of system. It doesn't have to be in the FPGA. It can participate in the network just like the blocks in the FPGA. So then we have external interfaces, which just adapt to the outside world. So you can have, for example, in an X300, we have a PCI Express interface and an Ethernet interface. The Ethernet interface will take a packet coming in, take off the IP, the UDP, the Ethernet headers, and just send the RFNoC packet into the RFNoC network. On the way back out, it takes the RFNoc packet, looks at the address, says, oh, I need to send this to IP address X, you know, 192 dot whatever. He puts the appropriate IP framing on that, sends it back out over the Ethernet. So within the green box of the crossbar, it's only pure RFNoc protocol, which is highly optimized to be in an FPGA. But outside, it's carried in the appropriate packetization for the outside world, whether that's USB packetization, Ethernet, IP, PCI Express, or anything else, really. Serial rapid I.O., you can connect this by any mechanism you like. So, and then we have the network fabric, which is the big green box in the middle, the radio transport router. So this is a full crossbar, and it routes packets between all the blocks, and because of the way we've designed the RFNoC protocol, the routing decisions are very easy. All routing information is in the very first line of a packet, and that's important. Not in a CPU, it doesn't matter. You can look at the whole packet and make a decision about routing. But in an FPGA, when something's on a FIFO, you just want to look at the head of the packet. You don't want to look deep in the packet to figure out where it goes, because that wastes resources. So we just look at the head of the packet, we send it to the right place, and so it's very highly efficient in an FPGA. And we have flow control to make sure that there's no clogging, there's no issues with starvation. And because of the way we do flow control, you can actually, in an automated way, you can have a program look at your design and tell you exactly how much bandwidth you'll have, what your worst case latency is, and you can reason and prove that there is no congestion. And that is important to being able to scale these systems, because a person doesn't have to think about it. You can prove that something will work a priori. And you don't have to sort of run it for a long time to see if it ever clogs because of probabilistic things. You can just know ahead of time that it's guaranteed to work or it won't. So just as an example, because we are on the X300, because we have, I keep hitting that, geez. We have all these, we have two Ethernets on each device, so you can actually daisy chain these devices. And any computation engine or any radio can send data to any other computation or radio without having to know where it is. It just has to know its address, and all of the router and the interface blocks figure out how to get it there. So now we have a glueless MIMO system that this is two antennas per device, so this is a 16 antenna glueless MIMO system with just cables between them. Now at some point you start to saturate your 10 gigabit links because you have so much bandwidth passing through some of them. And so you can scale beyond that by using a 10 gigabit switch. And so you can just attach radios to your 10 gig switch. Or you can also attach other computers. And so now any block can talk to any other block with a very low latency non-blocking switch in the middle via the local switches. And so it's a hierarchical network, and you can scale it. So we have people using this with 128 antennas doing MIMO systems where all 128 are fully synchronous with each other. And it's 128 by 128 on the base station end. This is, of course, experimental. It's not like a deployed thing yet, but it's experimental at a university in Sweden has one system, and a number of other universities. And on the other end, you have a one-by-one handset type of system. So it's 128 antennas on the base station side and one antenna in your hand. And it actually has some really amazing properties from a wireless capacity point of view. So I don't think I have, well, I lost a diagram in here somewhere. But basically, I'll go back to this. So to describe what a typical application might look like, let's say you have an OFDM transceiver. So your radio might receive samples and send those samples to the first block that looks at it and looks for what type of signal you have. And if he sees GSM, he forwards the samples onto the GMSK receiver. If he sees OFDM, he forwards it onto the OFDM synchronizer block, who then, once it's synchronized, forwards it onto the FFT, and the FFT block forwards it onto the turbo decoder. Right, so it's all stepwise, and it's all dynamic. It's on a packet-by-packet basis. Now, that OFDM sync block, he might see, you know, start synchronizing and sending the data out to the next guy in this chain, and at the same time, he might say, the amplitude is too low. I need to turn up the gain. So on his same network connection, he can send a control packet back to the radio to tell him to turn up the gain. Any block can control any other block, and that's a key part of the system. So that minimizes the latency. You don't need some host computer over there running AGC, and you don't need some hard-coded algorithm. Every block can control every other block. Of course, the reverse would happen on transmit. And so this is all very dynamic and flexible. So I know I threw a lot at you there. This is been something we've been working on for a year and a half now, and are really excited about. So if you have any questions, you know, either now or grab me later. But let me tell you where we are in status on this. And this slide's a little old. We have more done than it says here, but we have the radios implemented, the network fabric, external interfaces, all the flow control. We have a bunch of computation engines built. We don't, obviously we want to do more and make whole OFDM reference designs and things like that, but we have FIR filters and FFTs and all sorts of stuff like that up and running. We haven't yet demonstrated running it across multiple FPGAs, across devices. That's one of the things we're working on next. We do have it automated and automated the setup and routing process from within GNU Radio. So you can drag and drop blocks that correspond to computation engines in your GNU Radio flow graph, draw arrows between them, and it will route the data appropriately. It will also, when you select a bunch of computation engines and put them in your flow graph, it'll say, do I have an FPGA image that has all of these computations in it? Yes, use that image. If I don't have it, it'll create a make file, an automated build script, to build an FPGA image that has all of those things. So you never need to touch Verilog or VHDL. It will automatically build it for you. Now, that build process is like an hour these days because the Xilinx tools, and there's nothing we can really do about that. Although we are working with some people on fixing that issue. It's highly automated, and you can do it all graphically. You can never touch text and create a custom flow graph that will do stuff in the host and in the FPGA. This we can do. It should be out of the to-do, but it does automatically build the FPGA image with the user-selected computation engines. We do not yet take advantage of partial reconfiguration. We plan to as soon as Xilinx gets that right. We do also have the skeleton reference computation engines for Verilog and VHDL, and we're working on them for the other environments. So the idea is any computation engine has a simple but still substantial amount of protocol you have to do, and so we don't want everybody to have to rewrite that. So we wrote a wrapper that will implement all of the protocol stuff and gives you a nice simple interface that's just AXI in, AXI out. If you know Xilinx FPGAs, it is a nice clean interface. So you can just go to, like, Xilinx CoreGen will give you an FFT. You just take their FFT, you wrap it in our wrapper, it works as an RFNoC computation engine. You want an FIR filter, take the Xilinx FIR generator, tell it your parameters, and you can even make it reprogrammable over our network, put it in the wrapper, and you have a reprogrammable FIR filter. All graphical, no text writing. You don't have to touch your keyboard. So that's all working. We're going to release code and do actual live demos of this at the GNU Radio conference And if you really do want to go, I know a guy, so I can see if we can fit you in. But but it is sold out, and we, which itself we're very proud of, to imagine that we'd have 150 people plus wanting to go to this. We had like 50 at our first one 3 years ago, so we're really excited about that. So anyway, I'll be around today and tomorrow, and hopefully in the demo room showing a B200. And yeah, and if anybody has any questions now or later, please let me know.
Yeah, I was just curious what features you get in LabVIEW FPGA that you don't in GNU Radio?
So LabVIEW FPGA, so GNU Radio itself is not really targeting the FPGA, right? It's mostly host code, and we have our add-ons to target RFNoC. So LabVIEW is, so LabVIEW is host mode, would correspond to GNU Radio, and then LabVIEW FPGA, there's not really a GNU Radio direct equivalent. But in any case, if you take LabVIEW plus LabVIEW FPGA, call it the LabVIEW ecosystem, it has some advantages for educational use in that there's pre-done courseware to go with it, and it has a very complete signal processing library, and it's easier to install, it's more Windows-oriented, so it's more a matter of taste. We personally, at Ettus Research, we're part of National Instruments, so we help the rest of National Instruments do the drivers, but we're GNU Radio folks ourselves. So really, I tell people, if you're comfortable in LabVIEW, use that. If you're comfortable in GNU Radio, use that. If you don't, here, you know, I think they're both good.
Hey, Matt. Yeah, really interesting talk. My question is, have you posted anything yet on the RF NOC like protocol? Is there anything that I can read on the spec?
Pieces of this presentation I actually presented last year at GNU Radio conference. The actual spec document and the code that implements all of this is going to be posted in 2 weeks when we announce at GNU Radio conference.
Cool.
So it'll all be up there.
Thanks.
So the algorithmic granularity of this is still at the complete processing picture is still at the FPGA level. Mm-hmm. There's the ability to parallel multiple FPGAs doing a MIMO scenario.
Right.
But you're not able to do things or wanting to do things that exceed the computational capabilities, at least from an algorithmic point of view, of single FPGAs.
Oh, okay. So an RFNoC block is going to fit in. Must, as it's constituted now, would have to fit in one FPGA. So actually, let me take it from the other end of that discussion. An RFNoC block it makes sense to be sort of a full algorithm, so like an FFT or a FIR filter. It does not make sense to do an adder in an RFNoC block. The overhead would be silly, right? You wouldn't do, if you were making a FIR filter, you wouldn't have a NOC block for each stage. You would have one FIR filter in the NOC block. So in that sense, it's very similar to GNU Radio itself, where you don't make individual blocks for the components of a FIR filter, you instantiate a FIR filter. So RFNoC is really the logical equivalent of GNU Radio blocks in an FPGA. It's a way of doing GNU Radio in FPGAs, essentially. So that's on the small side. There's a certain granularity that below it doesn't make sense to do in a NOC block. It makes sense to put a lot of things together into one block. On the high side, you could make an entire 802.11n, OFDM receiver, MIMO, everything in one NOC block. You could do that. That sort of misses the point of having the interchangeable blocks. It would make more sense, or it would be more in the spirit of the way the system is designed, to have the FFT as one block, the synchronizer as one block, and that's the sort of the granularity where it's most comfortable. That being said, if you have a block, like if the FFT is always followed by the DMOD, right, then you don't necessarily have to put them in separate blocks and have the overhead. You could just cram them together. And the system actually makes it easy to, you just take the wrapper off, put them together, and put the wrapper back around both of them together. And so it makes it easier to do that. So what you would lose is that you lose the flexibility of you can't jump into the middle of the two components. But it's sort of you always have this trade-off in the sort of the computer world between fine granularity and flexibility versus overhead, right? So you can err on the side of every tiny little thing, separate, and then you get a lot of overhead, or if you put everything together, you get no flexibility, but no overhead. And so we're sort of in the sweet spot between that, we hope. So not adders, but not whole radios. It's algorithms, how I put it. So an algorithm fits appropriately within a NOC block.
And I'm afraid that's all the time we have. Okay. Thank you very much, Matt.
Thank you.